So now I'm going to talk about the phenomenon of wave localization, and in particular one of the wave localization and disorder, and in particular one of the instances of it, which is the famous now Anderson localization. The story goes at least back 50 years when Anderson got Nobel Prize for it, or actually before, when he has introduced the concept. And I have here the controversial citation about the indignity of numerical simulations, which I felt is a good first page for this seminar. But the story today is more about the new concept that we have introduced with Marcel Fellows by now some years ago, the landscape of localization. And the big collaboration which came out of it, which in particular showed that the landscape can be used both in pure mathematics and in applications to predict a lot of properties of localized waves, including the geometric properties such as the location of localized eigenfunctions, the rate of the exponential decay, the properties concerning the energies, eigenvalues, integrated density of states, to an extent, the mobility age, and quantum observables, starting with Wigner functions, which sort of serve as a feed for the quantum observables, to spectral functions, to joint density of states, and possibly other things that we will be discussing. So, first of all, the project for us stemmed partially from the collaboration, or rather ended up in collaboration with people working with cold atoms and organic and non-organic semiconductors. And the punchline is that at a microscopic scale, most materials present some amount of disorder in them. In particular, you can see on the atomic map of indium gallium nitride, which makes up 99% of our LEDs, that one can observe disorder both in composition, in the geometry of quantum layers, and behind the scenes in the dielectric constant, and so on. Now, you could say it looks reasonably uniform from distance, what a little bit of disorder can do to a perfectly healthy LED. So let's look at the eigenfunctions now. So we are speaking now of solutions to Schrödinger equation, Laplacian plus V, C equals Epsi, let's say, so the eigenfunctions of the Schrödinger equation. And in the presence of no potential or constant potential, the eigenfunctions are, of course, sines and cosines uniformly distributed through the domain. When the potential is smooth, this picture is distorted, but not so much. And on the other hand, disorder truly changes everything. The former sines and cosines become exponentials, so it is a phenomenological mathematical change in the behavior of eigenfunctions. And in physics, the former conductor might become an insulator. When and where this happens, this is not a certainty, and even in the same system, for some energies it might, and for some other energies it might not be happening. Is exactly the subject of the study in the part of mathematics and physics that studies localization by disorder. And even in the particular case of Anderson localization, which is sort of the simplest, the most emblematic one that you've seen on the previous page, one still has many open problems, including the fact that the experimental experiments are very hard still to this date. There is a big chase after the critical exponents and the theoretical work, numerical work, the factual experiments do not give the same values. And finally, the mathematical proofs are rather scarce as well, and for now pertain to some extreme regimes. So either big potential, big disorder, or edges of the spectrum, or low dimension, dimension one only. If you haven't been thinking about this since, why is it so difficult to understand the behavior of waves compared to the behavior of particles, let's say? Well, because in the presence of obstacles, they do not exactly behave the way you expect the particles to behave. In a square quantum well, which you can see on the left-hand side here, if you were a particle, you would be just inside the well and not moving right or left. The waves tunnel through the barriers, so they decay exponentially, but they tunnel nonetheless. They can cross the barriers if they are not too sick. On the other hand, on the picture on the right-hand side, and this is the one I will be using a lot, so let me mention that this means that you make up a potential by chopping the square into, I don't know, n by n smaller squares, and then assigning the values, let's say, 1 and 0 with some probability. And I'm intentionally given 0 a somewhat bigger probability so that there is no temptation to think about a simple confinement. You don't actually have literally the barriers. In principle, if you were a particle, you would be able to cross from left to right and percolate fully. The waves nonetheless do not, and in particular, the fundamental state you see on the bottom, and what you see here is a logarithmic picture, logarithmic scale. So what it means is that the eigenfunction is really localized in here, and the rest of it is the exponentially decaying tail. So these are very small numbers. So it looks like the picture perceived by the waves is not the same as the picture perceived by us when we look at the disordered system and the potential in particular. And indeed, the punchline of our work is that you can put on sort of a goggles of a wave and create an object which is a solution to a particular PD, which tells you where the eigenfunctions are going to be localized, which predicts to an extent the pattern of exponential decay, as well as the energies, as well as eigenvalues and the energies of localized eigenfunctions, and ultimately, as we will see, even Wigner functions and quantum observables. And the goal is to develop this area in order to understand, predict, manipulate the states of matter, and ultimately create the new ones to sort of stop fighting localization and actually use it for creation of new materials and devices. I will give you just a couple of slides with sort of some results because I won't have too much time to go into all of them, but so that you have some scope, and then I'll concentrate on some particular ones. The landscape is a solution to HU equal one, where H is the Hamiltonian in the system. So H so far has been the Schrödinger operator minus Laplacian plus V. It can be a more general Hamiltonian. And whatever it is, HU equals one has a unique solution, and the solution is what we will be referring to as the landscape. First of all, it gives the uniform upper bound on all eigenfunctions normalized in the L infinity norm. The importance of this fact is that the partition sort of suggested by the landscape affects the somewhat of weakened boundaries viewed by the eigenfunction. So it really gives the results as per where the eigenfunctions will be localized, where the essential support is. It introduces the manifold, which explains what is the rate of the exponential decay. We will talk about this much more. It allows to understand the energy levels, and in particular, the bottom of the spectrum is just the dimensional multiple of the minimum of 1 over u of the reciprocal of the landscape. You see the picture here. It also explains the situation all the way across the spectrum. If you consider the well associated now to the landscape, it will give the results not only at the bottom of the spectrum, but sort of throughout the entire picture. It gives further the transport properties, and finally the location of the eigenfunction in phase space. So not only you can understand space separately and energy separately, but you can actually understand the phase space picture for the eigenfunction. And that gives the information about spectral functions, about joint density of states and semiconductors, and about other features of the system. But let's go one by one. I'll emphasize three parts of the story as far as mathematics of it goes. And first of all, we start with the support and with the exponential decay. So in some sense, the geometric properties of the eigenfunctions. It turns out that the key feature is not so much the landscape, but it's reciprocal, whenever you. And what happens is that if you take the initial Schrödinger equation and you conjugate it by 1 over u, you get a new equation in which the original potential V completely disappears. 1 over u becomes the potential. And at the same time, the initial Laplacian becomes a sort of Laplace-Beltrami on another manifold. To be completely honest, it is Laplace-Beltrami if you lift it one dimension up. This one is more or less a weighted Laplacian, but the model nonetheless behaves. It sort of gives you the potential and it gives you the manifold in which the eigenfunctions are propagated. Now, you would say in principle, what did you change? You have replaced one bad potential but another by another bad potential. But the deal is that this new one is much better structured than in those unclear sort of systems made of random square blocks. The landscape, or one over the landscape, shows this beautiful picture of chambers and passages, and these are Doug Arnold's computations, by the way, which actually shows clearly the vision of the eigenfunctions and how the eigenfunctions are decaying. In particular, we can prove, and this is by now a few years old result, that if you take more generally even than Schrödinger minus Dvi grad plus V, so you're working on some manifold in the presence of the potential, or let's say on a Lipschitz subdomain of a manifold, and you take any level of energy E, and now you cut 1 over U, 1 over the landscape at this energy level. So you took the map of, oops, I'm sorry. You took the map of the landscape, and let's say you are cutting it at the level of energy E. The wells below this level of energy are going to host the eigenfunctions, and the walls above this energy level are exactly what is going to give you the rate of the exponential decay. In the sense that if you put a metric on this new manifold, the manifold given by 1 over u minus lambda, the eigenfunctions decay exponentially in the metric, in the distance borne by the metric given by the landscape. The proper statement, the proper mathematical statement you see here, it's necessarily an L2 because in this generality it must be, but basically morally you should be thinking that the eigenfunction decay exponentially according to the metric given by the landscape. You could ask how precise this is because after all this is sort of an estimate from above. All I'm saying is that there is an L2 control. And this is one of the examples. This is by now a familiar potential made up of ones and zeros. This is one of the eigenfunctions, or rather it's log, so it's the logarithmic scale. So basically every change in color is an exponential drop, is the pattern of the exponential drop. And on the right-hand side, you see the answer given by the landscape now. It's pretty close. It's not identical, but this goes all the way to e to minus 36, and the pattern is actually pretty close, as the theorem predicts, but probably better than we could even hope from what the theorem really predicts. What this further gives is diagonalization. So from here, you can go and prove that if you split your system according to whatever the landscape requires, then the eigenfunctions of the big system are exponentially close to the eigenfunctions of the small cells, and vice versa, and the eigenvalues as well. So you have a sort of exponential decoupling, exponentially precise decoupling of your system into the smaller subregions. So what I mean by this is you take again, some sort of potential like this, you take the landscape, and then you draw what we call a valley network. And you should think of it as the valley network, in the sort of geographical sense of the world, the lines of steepest descent, something like this. And this splits the domain into the individual mountains, or for 1 over u into individual wells. And with this picture, when we start looking at the eigenfunctions, we see that they're indeed supported in the cells predicted by the landscape. and even repeat them with shape. And you can go, I mean, there is a movie somewhere, but you can go until 200 or something like this. It's a pretty boring movie because they just walk the individual cells of the landscape. And then at some point, it has energies, the landscape starts giving up, but we still know how. I mean, it's all governed by the level sets of the reciprocal of the landscape. So we know exactly how the system degenerates. And indeed, when it does, the eigenfunctions start going through, but they're still governed by the same phenomenon. Some analog of this result can be obtained also for magnetic Schrödinger. Behind it, there is a certain new uncertainty principle, which basically says that the landscape absorbs a lot of information about both kinetic and potential energy. An analog of this uncertainty principle was proved by my student Bruno Poggi a few years ago, and this yields some version of this result for the magnetic Schrödinger operator. There are some satisfactory, some less satisfactory part about the magnetic case, but I will not dwell on it too much here. But in principle, there is some analog. There is also an analog in the more general context of random matrices. There, the relevant questions are slightly different because so Schrödinger is a random matrix in which you have three diagonal matrix and there are ones on upper and lower diagonal and random values in the middle on the main diagonal, at least in 1D. Otherwise, you have a few of those. You can generalize the question to thicker band matrices. And the big conjecture in the random matrix theory is that localization, delocalization transition is at the square root of n, meaning that when the width of the band is about square root of n, that's when before that, the eigenfunctions are localized, and beyond that, they are not anymore. There is a number of results. None of them is coming close to the square root. We looked at the slightly different things, not exactly presence or absence of localization, but actually the analog of results that I showed you before about the rate of the exponential decay. And this is the joint work with Marcel Filoche and Terry Tao, and indeed we have the full analog of the results I showed you on the previous slide. I mean, it looks somewhat scary, but you know, I assure you this is just the discrete or rather random matrix analog of previous results. I mean, this is the natural analog of the metric and natural analog of landscape and things like this. So more or less, something like this is also true in the more general context of random matrices. The proof is different, but the gist is the same. And one of the things that you can do with that, one of the things which is actually much more recent than that, sort of results of the last year, is to look at the mobility age. And this in particular is joint with the cold atoms group of the collaboration, and well, we're featuring Alana Speck, who just got the Nobel Prize last year. And for them, the main issue is to observe, I mean, this is experimental physics, and the main issue is to observe the so-called mobility age, which is transition between localized and delocalized regime. So what happens is that even in the pictures that I showed you before, for low, at least in higher dimensions, in dimension three and higher, it is believed that for low energies, the eigenfunctions are localized. And for high energies, they are not, and that there is a very clear phase transition between the two. As a matter of fact, we know that there is a clear phase transition between the two if there is delocalization. Unfortunately, no one has been able to prove delocalization so far, but the chase for the mobility age is relevant both in pure mathematics and in experiment, and in numerical mathematics as well, because these are really far from easy computations. It so happened that just last year we had the both relevant results in experiment for the first time, and they had the breakthrough on their end, and the first results in the landscape theory for mobility age in the theoretical end. I will not give you the experimental details. I mean, this is basically the first observation of effective observation of the mobilization, the systems of cold atoms, which actually corresponds to the predictions. But I will tell you what happens on the theoretical end of it. As you saw from the first picture of mine, when I'm sort of showing the initial potential, the percolation of the potential has really nothing to do with localization of eigenfunctions. I mean, the very first picture was the potential which was fully percolating, and the eigenfunctions were nonetheless localized. So it's not a percolation question, and emphatically not so. It turns out, however, that it is a percolation question, likely, in the world driven by the landscape. That if you translate the original potential into the landscape picture, into the or effective potential, one over U picture, then suddenly percolation and this new potential actually shows at least part of the mobility age. And I won't describe the pictures in too many details. This is the standard localized, delocalized diagram for people who have been working on this. But basically, the point is that in black, you have the observational data of the mobility age in dimension three. And in red, you have the data predicted by the percolation of the landscape. It's pretty close, and it's pretty close in very different regimes. So in particular for Anderson uniformly distributed potential and for the Bernoulli potentials, which I have been showing, the picture is different. And so is the picture of percolation of the landscape. But in both cases, it actually follows. Now, if you actually try to study this from the point of view of theory of percolation, the typical beginning that you need to have is probabilistic properties of the landscape. Because the normal sort of context of percolation theory is that you have a certain process with some probability law, and you're asking yourself how the percolation is going through this. So you need to understand the probabilistic properties of U or 1 over U. This was the subject of our work with Guy David and Antoine Gloria, and among other things, we proved that the well, let's say the important thing is that the covariance, the correlations in the landscape are exponentially weak, and so this is basically an independent process for all practical purposes, and this is what likely can then be fed into the localization results. Although this just has happened, so we haven't pushed it further just yet. But we do have the expected results on both expectation and covariance of landscape data, landscape potential. And with that, let me switch to the energies. So as we have discussed, there are basically two main properties of the eigenfunctions. One of them is the geometry and the shape, and one of them is the eigenvalue, and respectively, the energies and the systems. We have discussed the first, let's talk about the second. Here, the story started with, well, one of the bits of the story started with the observation that minima of 1 over u, minima of the reciprocal of the landscape, basically give numerical multiples of the eigenvalues. And you see the results over here. So first, the numerical observations. This is a 2D80 Bayesian grid, similarly to what I was showing to you before. The minima of 1 over u, first 100 minima are in green. The first 100 eigenvalues are in blue. And the ratio is indeed very close to 1.5. And our prediction is 1 plus n over 4, where n is dimensional. Notice that the important point about this is that the multiple is dimensional. So it's a blind machine. You don't know how the potential was created to start with. You don't know what probability law gave it. You just feed it into the landscape, take a picture of minima, and you know the eigenvalue, sort of, give or take. And on the right-hand side, you see more numerical computations. Now, both of them are by Doug. The blue is 1D, the red is 2D, and the green is 3D. And there are sort of patches of different eigenvalues, and you see the really uncanny coincidence. Some of this has been proved by now by our postdocs. So we have the first one-dimensional results, and that you can see over here in the bottom, and they're working on more. But meanwhile, as you understand, this can only be sort of addressed in the bottom of the spectrum for the simple reason that there are fewer minima than there are eigenvalues. If you have a finite system, there is a finite number of minima and there is an infinite number of eigenvalues, and that persists. The landscape, on the other hand, knows the sort of knows the spectrum throughout the system. And the way to see it is through a modification of the while loop. So the while loop in its original form says that the eigenvalues, the number of eigenvalues below the level of energy E, the count of eigenvalues should be given by the count in the volume and phase space of K squared plus V less equal than E. This is an asymptotic result. It's valid as E goes to infinity. It's not valid at the bottom of the spectrum, neither morally nor in any other sense. I mean, basically, what you do is you count the eigenvalues of the Laplacian on a square. And so the precision of the while loop is a combination of how well you can approximate your level domain with squares and how close V is to a constant on every square. So if your V doesn't oscillate too wild, eventually, on small squares it becomes, but that's why the result is sort of generally asymptotic, just more or less asymptotic. It's not true at the bottom, and there are many important counterexamples. On the other hand, when you substitute the original potential with 1 over U, the results look amazingly close. Meaning what? So this is one of the examples, and blue is the reality. So this is a step function which adds 1 every time you encounter an eigenvalue in blue. In green is the original while loop. It will coincide asymptotically, but not at the bottom. And in red is the landscape version of the while loop, which is, needless to say, much closer. It took quite a bit of time to prove this result, several years actually. And what turned out to be right is, interestingly enough, not exactly this version, but the version combining this with the previous conversation about the minimum of 1 over U. So the right count turns out to be as follows. You introduce the following counting function. You take your space, you chop it into the boxes of size 1 over square root of lambda, which is basically your wavelength. And then you count the number of cubes such that on the cube, minimum of 1 over U is less equal than lambda. So these are not just sort of global local minima anymore. This is just the count of minimum of 1 over U on a given cube. So it combines the first observation about the multiples of the minima and the effort to count the volume, because eventually it becomes approximable by the volume and the phase space. But long story short, it gives an estimate from above and below on the integrated density of states, in general with a certain polynomial correction. But for all practical purposes, if U squared is doubling, or if V is disordered, or if V is periodic, I mean, like basically any potential you are trying to build up is going to give you an estimate from above and below by the same quantity, with constants which depend on dimension only, as opposed to depending on the potential or the energy. So you simply have to count the minima of the landscape, and with that you have rather full understanding of the integrated density of states of the eigenvalues in the system. The constants are independent on smoothness of V, independent on the size of V, independent on the size of the domain, and most importantly, independent on the energies. To the best of my knowledge, this is the first result independent on the energy. This is the first version of the while loop, which is actually not asymptotic, and which treats general potentials, which is not ad hoc to a given potential. I mean, we have no assumptions on the on the size of the potential as well. And this is joint with Guy David and Marcel Feloce. And then there was a second paper for discrete version of this result with in which Dagarnold and our postdocs Juan and Jean have joined for the tight binding model. With that, you can play various games. In particular, you can discuss disordered potentials and such things as the so-called Lipschitz tail, the exponential decay of the integrated density of states at the bottom of the spectrum. The results are actually amazingly precise. You can even see logarithmic correction, while sort of the best general previously available ones were at the level of log log. But really, the strength of the result is not as much that as the fact that we can treat all potentials and that the system is blind to the features of the potential. You don't need it to be disordered. You don't need it to be periodic. You don't need it to be in a certain LP or things like this. And you really address all the eigenvalues, contrary to sort of any available techniques. I'll skip the ideas of the proof, perhaps. Again, this is not the traditional while law. We are sort of combining this new uncertainty principle with some Poincaré considerations, with using landscape as a proxy for ansatz of eigenfunctions, at least partially, and similar features. But I do want to talk about the picture and the play space a bit. So now that we have a rather precise understanding of the spatial picture of eigenfunctions and the energy picture. There is, one becomes greedy and you want to be able to understand whether the landscape can actually predict the composition of the phase space entirely. So in some sense, we are speaking of the fact that we know something about the two projections. Can we actually know something about the entire space? This is, of course, not a given, but this would be extremely powerful because that then gives you the prediction of all quantum observables and things like this. And the traditional lens to look at the scene is through the Wigner function, whose definition you see on the slide. So it sends an eigenfunction to a function of x and k of two variables. And what it does is it sort of gives the probability distribution of an eigenfunction in the phase space. Sort of because, so the entire integral of the Wigner function is one. The projection on X is the observable of X, Psi X squared. The projection on K is the Fourier transform, Psi hat of k squared, so it's really giving you in projection sort of the phase picture and the space picture faithfully. And on top of it, the product of the Wigner functions, the integral of the product of the Wigner functions is equal to the product of eigenfunctions for any other two functions squared. And what it means is that since the eigenfunctions are orthogonal, so are Wigner functions. And again, the integral is one. So if they were positive, that would mean that they sort of pave the phase space perfectly and give you the composition of the phase space as viewed by the occupation of eigenfunctions, both in energy and in space. This is not exactly the case. This is not a probability distribution. They are not necessarily positive, which makes the situation more complicated. But actually, sort of modified by a proper Gaussian, meaning by Gaussian given by the uncertainty principle size, they end up being. So if you zoom out this picture a little bit, this is really some analog of the decomposition. The strength of this story is that if you take now any Hermitian operator, you put into correspondence the Weyl transform, the symbol of the operator and the corresponding quantization. You can see the definition here. All of these are just identities, formulas. And then the average of A on this eigenfunction, defined on the left-hand side, the way you see it, is actually equal to the integral of the beginner function weighted by the symbol, against the symbol. So it's sort of a language to explain to you how to predict the operators, how to predict the quantum observables, knowing the position of the eigenfunctions. So with this, you can in principle rewrite things, and in particular, you can rewrite the energy, as you can see over here, as an integral of the Wigner function against k squared plus v. You can also rewrite it as, you know, a triple integral, an integral on E times the integral on shells, you know, roughly speaking around E, E plus minus D of the Wigner function, which should be an integral of E against the PDF. So in principle, everything sounds good so far, and PDF is what you are looking for. You know, this is sort of the holy grail. This is really what you are trying to understand. The problem is that the fact that two integrals are equal doesn't mean that two integrands are equal. And indeed, they shouldn't be, because otherwise the Y law would be perfectly true without any asymptotics or anything like this. So not only this doesn't imply that what's inside is equal, but it cannot possibly. But now you sort of know the rules of the game. You substitute V by 1 over U, and you see what happens. And what happens is, again, sort of surprisingly precise, in the sense that the level lines of k squared plus 1 over u equals e indeed do predict the location of the Wigner function. So what you are looking at here in these pictures, in red and blue, you see Wigner functions of individual eigenfunctions, or rather like the sum of 10 of them. So a little bit of a spectral band. Couple of examples, one at low energy, at one at high energy. And in black, you see the level lines of k squared plus 1 over u equals e. And the key observation is that these level lines give the sort of location of the essential support of the Wigner function rather precisely. At least they delimit one. Same happens, you know, across different regimes, what we call, actually here both pictures are in the quantum regime. This is low energy and high energy. Same would happen in the semi-classical regime. But what you are observing here is that you couldn't play this game with V, indeed, with the original potential. Because if you try to play it with the original potential, you have sort of incorrect spurious information. So this is the level lines of k squared plus v. Below are the level lines of k squared plus 1 over u. And same for the high energy states. So you can see that the original potential v really doesn't do the job nearly as faithfully, and 1 over u is more precise. So whether or not you can prove something about it, and I will show you that we can soon enough, but I mean the first idea that happened from here was to try to predict the values of the spectral functions, and this is truly both sort of the idea to use Wigner transforms in this context and the idea to use spectral functions goes back to Marcel. So when you try to play it for the spectral function, you basically need a histogram of the values of the effective potential 1 over u. And here again are the pictures. So deep quantum regime means that your potential is sort of on par with the Laplacian or smaller. The classical regime is, or semi-classical regime if you wish, is when the potential, when the disorder is large. So you are sort of, you can use semi-classical approximation. And in red, you see the state-of-the-art estimates, the actual experimental data. In green, you see the best previously available results, semi-classical ones. And in blue, you see the landscape-based. So when the regime is semi-classical, the semi-classical ones do pretty well as well. But the beauty of it is that the landscape does well across all of these regimes, whether it's classical or whether we go into deep quantum regime. And blue is quite close to red, to the reality. What can we prove about it? Well, proving sense about the Wigner function is extremely difficult. There's, despite the fact that we are saying that, in projections it's simply an eigenfunction squared, and in the other projection it's simply the Fourier transform squared, its shape, honestly, it's not that easy. I mean, for instance, here you are looking at the infinite well, so this is basically, the Dirichlet eigenfunction of a segment, and you are looking at its Wigner representation, and of course on the projection on X you can see a sine wave. In the projection on Fourier space, you can see simply a delta function, essentially. But the Wigner function itself is pretty complicated. And as a matter of fact, even the first semi-classical results describing the Wigner function date only a few years ago, and are basically for harmonic oscillator. That's basically all that was available before us. So Hanin and Zeldich have proved in 2019, sort of the asymptotics, for now only asymptotics for the Wigner function or harmonic oscillator. And then in 2022, this was published, I think, already after Steve Zeldich passed away, for potentials which sort of resemble harmonic oscillator. I mean, these are potentials with at most quadratic growth, which whose level curves are convex, whose level sets are convex. So definitely none of our weird potentials in which your level sets are made of these very strange shapes. So the question is, what can you do about it in our generality? What can you even conjecture in our generality? Because looks like is not really mathematics. And here is a matter of fact. So this is a conjecture by Charlie Pfefferman. He suggested that there should be a shell near c squared plus 1 over u equals e, which contains the essential mass of the Wigner transform. That it's not just about the Wigner function being contained inside the curve, it's the fact that if you integrate the Wigner function, its integral is basically contained inside, its mass is basically contained inside the shell. So what it means is that on this picture, this oscillation, it integrates out to zero. So compared to what I was showing you before, this is a stronger even conjecture, because here what I was saying is that the eigenfunctions, the Wigner function of eigenfunction is to be found inside the level curve of 1 over u, k squared plus 1 over u equals e. This is the conjecture that the mass, meaning, a region on which integral is essentially supported, is around this curve. That everything inside oscillates to zero, that there is a strong cancellation inside this region, which is what you actually need to prove strong theorems. We are still working on this. At this point, we have the first results towards this conjecture. They don't look pretty yet, but they're very fresh. I mean, this is not only not published, but barely typed. We are still pushing it towards the landscape, but for now we have some slightly different smoothing of the potential. I won't walk you through the details. So landscape isn't some sort, giving you an alternative potential. This is a slightly different way to give you an alternative potential, comparing the variations of V to sort of the size of the ball on which we are taking variations, then decomposing the space according to Gaussians based on that decomposition. And then we are proving that the Wigner function of the eigenfunction projected on this, sequence of bumps, if you want, is small away from the shell. So basically what this is proving is that you have a region which is a combination of packets, what we call deep inside the forbidden region. This is where the oscillation happens. And what we call off-shell points of the allowed regions. So this is, where you are sort of out of this entire region. But on the combination of two, you have a strong decay as you go away from the shell. So the farther you go away from the shell of this new average of V plus C squared equals E, either farther inside or farther outside, the smaller is the off-print of your Wigner function. something like that. So this is a slightly different version. This is not exactly the landscape yet, and I'm not sure, you know, what it will become in the ultimate version, but it also carries no assumptions on V. It carries no assumption on the underlying energy, and it sort of gives the first non-asymptotic results compared to Hanyin and Zeldish, and the first results independent on the nature of the potential compared to Hanyin and Zeldish, which give you the support of the Wigner function. And I think I'll finish here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Svetlana. So I don't see any questions yet, but I think it's going to come. I suppose people can talk, right?
Yes, they can. If they are panelists, they can. If they are attendees, please put question, either raise your hands or put the question in the question and Q&A. And I actually have a question, Zetan. A very nice talk. So if I understood correctly, you always assume IIDs, correct? So
Well, not in theorems, right? So I mean, in pictures, yes. But all the theorems are deterministic, with one exception of that theorem with Ghia and Antoine Gloria, where we are actually proven that if the potential is probabilistic, then 1/U is probabilistic. With that exception, all the theorems are deterministic. I don't
in
assume
the
anything. I
deterministic,
mean,
yeah.
I just have a bounded potential, you know, I haven't said
Okay.
anything yet. And
But
it's actually bounded from below because all I need
right,
positivity
yeah,
in the
right,
Hamiltonian.
yeah. But my question is, I would assume that in real situation, I mean, the field is correlated. You know, it's not the correlated. So there is a way to take advantage of the correlation.
So for us, again, it's hardly relevant because all the theorems are deterministic.
Yeah.
Factually, for the effects of localization and the like, I mean, depends on the correlations, right? So I mean, you sort of can understand that it depends on whether your correlations surpass the, you know, the projected localization lengths in some sense.
Right.
So if it's exponentially correlated, nobody really cares. You know, if it's polynomial, it becomes sensitive and things like this. But in fact, I mean, even some results here. So the cold atoms ones are correlated. So
Right.
they actually have, I mean, it's sort of a square. In my world, it's a square of the correlated potential. It's an intensity. Our theorems are absolutely blind to probability. Again, with one exception when we actually targeted the probabilistic properties of the landscape. Everything else is just, you know, bounded measurable coefficients and bounded from below potential.
Thank you.
Our questions are.
Oh, I have a question.
Good.
So for this theorem here, do you have any assumption for V, for the potential here?
Not yet, meaning that for this,
It's
like
bounded?
literally for this theorem, so we prove it on the I don't think I need it bounded even, but we prove it on the torus with
Horace.
all constants independent on the size of the domain. So sort
Okay.
of behind this, but all constants are independent of the size of the domain. So if you wish, you know, you could say that you are taking a bounded domain and a bounded potential, and then you prove that everything is independent on either the size of the domain or an infinity norm of the potential, which means that in the limit, if the limit makes sense, you have the estimate.
Okay.
Whether or not the limit makes sense, or how, you know, how it has to be normalized to make sense, is sort of pertinent to particular situation.
Okay. I'm also wondering, maybe it's another question. So for this kind of result, does the regularity of potential play some role in this inequality?
No, and this is very interesting and sort of very unexpected in some sense. So we are there is absolutely no assumption on the oscillations of the potential. And this is actually different from anything. I mean, there are no assumptions on the gradient, there are no assumptions on the second derivative, there are no assumptions on the oscillations. I mean, we are choosing the grid according to oscillations. So sort of behind the scene is the fact that the composition of the phase space. So, you know, basically what happens is that we are decomposing the phase space into cubes. Cubes being, you know, different on x, different on xi, and you have to choose very carefully, you know, the both coordinates. I mean, it's in your interest to make as refined the composition as possible. It has to be bounded at least by uncertainty principle, so it cannot be below volume one for every single cube. But nonetheless, you know, the choice of the composition is very careful. So the choice of the composition, the choice of our balls, the choice of the sizes is sort of governed by the variations of the potential. But the model of this fact, the result is not.
Okay.
So, I mean, it's sort of like I'm creating, you know, looking at the oscillations of the potential, I'm creating a decomposition of the phase space. But then the precision with which this decomposition of the phase space tells you where the Wigner function is independent on the oscillations of the potential.
Okay, I see.
So
yeah, thank you.
It's the geometry which is dependent. It's not the precision of analysis. It's not the estimate.
Okay, yeah, thank you.
Questions? So maybe before people have to give more chances. So I think so. This thing, I suppose, the problem is that, of course, you don't know whether B of EL is a very large set of wave packets. And also, similarly, you know, there is this unpleasant thing that here you're saying that some things have small size. And then there is this unpleasant thing that when you're talking about the difference between mass or, you know, integral of a function W and integral of absolute value of W. Is there any, you know, any hint? I mean, do you know where this thing would come from?
But that's exactly this, right? I'm killing the oscillations, meaning that I'm looking at the integral of W, if you wish, not the integral of absolute value of W. Because I'm actually, you know, part of my theorem is saying, our theorem is saying that inside the oscillations basically annihilate each other. I don't know, nor do I care what's the L1 norm of the full Wigner function, because already in the square well case, if you look at the L1 norm of this animal, it's horrendous inside and this shouldn't carry any information. Right, so this blue and red inside is certainly larger in, you know, L1 or L infinity norm than anything on the shell, and there should be spurious information in some sense, because these are constellations which kill each other at the uncertainty principle level.
But versus the wave packets that you forbid, they do not contribute to a large L1 norm yet, right?
So I mean, I have wave packets living in here,
yeah,
which show that it's basically zero inside.
But
so I'm I'm covering
not,
the
yeah.
inside as well by the wave packets.
But you mean even with B of EL, right? Okay, good.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so better than.
So the only thing, and I mean, L is not as bad, meaning that it's our choice, right? This is true for every L, by the way. So I should be saying that then for every L, I mean, like. Bigger than three or something, but it's true for every L. But notice that the L is in our choice of the shell, and L is in our result. So what I mean by this is that, you know, depending on the width of the shell is the level of my precision. So I'm saying that if, you know, in proper units in some sense, and proper, you know, increments, if I take this contour, if I take in proper increments the L neighborhood of the contour, then the Wigner function outside is smaller than 1 over L, basically, for every L. You'd say it's not a super strong decay, meaning that, you know, I take an L neighborhood, and all I'm saying is that the Wigner function, the integral of Wigner function, is smaller than 1 over L. But let me remind you that without any assumptions on the potential, you cannot do better than that, because Fourier transform of the function, which is not smooth, is actually pretty bad. So it's sharp on a square well. Simply because on the square well, you have, when you Fourier transform the you know, the corners, you're going to gain a lot on the Xi variable. The Fourier transform is going to be really bad. So in order to ameliorate it, one could do one of the two things: either make a better theorem with L dependent on E, which is probably what we want to do, meaning that, you know, to give you better results asymptotically, for example, because certainly in the semi-classical limit you can do better than that. Certainly at the bottom you cannot do better than that already at the level of the square well. At least, you know, in these terms. I mean, depends of course on how you define things, but at least in these terms you cannot. Or version number two, you could, you know, ask, what if I, you know, make a different potential. Or version number three, you could ask, what if my cubes are turning? Meaning that, I mean, this is cubes, you know, x by xi. I mean, they're not equal size, but they're nonetheless something next time something like xi, they're products. So you could say that maybe it makes sense to turn the cubes, but that, you know, enters into decoupling and that sort of sense. It's all interesting. It's all something we haven't done yet. I mean, this is literally, you know, like I was copying from a file which I saw for the first time this Sunday, so it's very fresh.